Yeah. Oh, yeah.
How do I get out of here? Back to where I belong.
I miss a little rolling up inside the cocktail. Vibes and a couple drops of sunshine. Good enough to pick and choose the always over sometimes. Pour a little out, we like to live a lot. And I make better decisions when I'm hot. We're taking dreams from my seats at the hangout spot. No plan for the night, but we all stay locked. Right in ice cream, no thunder or lightning. Just the view of the ocean and the sexy ass light skin girl. I'm going back and I'm headed for my paradise. My paradise where I can sit and write songs, eat a little food and we can share our lives in California. Got me thinking I should really take it easy. Out back with my crew and some girls if you need me. So when I say welcome home, you ask what do I mean? I mean you visit and you never wanna leave. Come find me.
How do I get out of here? Back to where I belong. California, California. Baby, I'm coming home. Oh yeah.
It's so sweet, so if it's just for the sport of football, that's just not enough. I'm going to be going into my 19th year at Campolindo, and in this area, the La Mirinda area, that's a long time for a coach. I almost joke, we joke, saying in La Mirinda years, that's like, you know, 50 years. We like our culture, we like our traditions, but we don't say our tradition is winning. All of our traditions and things we do that surround the program are more for the team building, you know, the brotherhood side of it. That's how we approach every year. Where we never talk that we're going to have big years. We only talk about how we want to make this the best football experience these kids can enjoy. Football, you've got your 10 games on the schedule, and any off-season you have is not glamorous off-season. We're always in a battle to try to find slivers of time to get the kids working with us. Spring practice, we say, you know, our true spring practice is Reno. We just run a skeleton crew with our 2 weeks that we're allowed in May because most of our kids are, and especially all the key contributors, skill position kids, are still playing another sport.
Somebody give me one more, cause I just ran out. I don't go to the clubs and I don't stand out. Ball to the wall in the basement, partying. Doesn't matter what bar we in or what car we in. Big red on the ones and twos. Now I know just what to do. Start going buck wild. Cutting up the rug in the middle of the music. Dealer's living room. It's like boom, how you like me now? Fans through the wave, so I surf the crowd. Speakers blown, cause we get so loud. Never sell out, but our show sold out.
Throughout the summer, we'll then try to put the team together. But we're not really ready to put the team together at Reno. But at least we start learning the pieces and what we can do, and the coaches then make all the adjustments.
Well, Reno, I feel like, is it's our first football, like tackle, like our first thing as a team together going before the season, getting ready for the summer, and just felt that toughness and all the stuff we go through in Reno really helps us get ready for the season.
Reno's always a great time. You know, it's always, it's hell, but it's the most fun form of hell you can go in. It's, you know, 3-day practices, waking up, I don't know, 6 in the morning, and walking up to the field for a 7 o'clock practice and have a 3 hour practice, walk back, have, you know, breakfast or lunch or whatever it was, and then go back and have another 3 hour practice, walk back, and then eat again, and then go back and have the last 3 hour practice of the day. And that went on for a few days.
When you think about going to a camp like Reno, it's a team camp. Most of the schools up there, they come from programs that have year-round football, a football class. Well, when they hit the field, they're ready to play. They've been in pads or been practicing. They're ready to play and compete. We're still just trying to put pieces together. So for us, we're at a disadvantage when we go to Reno in terms of trying to figure out if we can compete.
Go!
We get a lot out of it, and we have to go for that competition. I've always tell the parents, we pay to go to this camp because we're paying for access to other kids. We can't scrimmage ourselves. We can't find 11 kids to scrimmage against that can give us much of a look. I've always claimed in all my years of coaching, the best coaches are our opponents. And that's the only way our kids will allow us to instruct them, is when some other kid on another team is teaching them a lesson, you know, that they should have listened to the coaching. Otherwise, you know, unless you see things, game speed, something real, that the kids really can't connect to it, and then we get their attention. These other kids allow our staff to finally get our kids' attention.
You could still,
so we still want to go three
route, and now
Matt,
which is not.
And you run.
Down.
You open up
the round.
Hit.
Oh!
Oh! Reno is where we felt, okay, now we have a chance. We have the summer. Let's get the pieces together.
Reno.
Then it becomes a battle, you know, who we're going to see the rest of the summer. We do it middle of July, we do our camp.
All of us kind of growing up in this area start out playing flag football. I know a lot of people from other areas start out with like peewee football, peewee tackle football. So, but we all do the flag football thing, and that was just a great experience. I think we all really enjoyed playing flag football growing up. And so our first really chance to get to play actual tackle football was at the Campo football camps every summer.
Do it!
It starts at a young age here. Most of us are kind of raised in the summer camps here. So you kind of grow up in the program, you know what it's about, you know Coach Macy from a young age, and then you make all these friends at football camp and you do everything together, and then you just get closer and closer as you move and move up and get older, and then by the time you're here, you're inseparable and it's nothing but.
I grew up in California, went to public schools, played ball on the blacktop every afternoon. Me and my friends said problems just the same as you.
It's a crazy environment. You're like, there's nothing like camp or football. So
Off, and so many of those kids in the eighth grade camps have been here since they were in fourth grade. You'll see the little helmet here. We had the little special logo from the year that we went 14-0, and then we went down to state. All the kids that made, most of the kids that made up that team started as fourth graders, and they just worked their way through the system from fourth grade all the way to seniors. And we were not a specially talented group of kids, but they were a bunch of kids that just stuck with this sport and became friends through it. And that's what made the difference that year.
A lot of people may not think too much about, you know, about what a, you know, a high school football game, but you know, when you see something special, for the players that are involved, it's obviously memories that are carried with you for quite a long time. And you know, when you look at a season like Campolindo had, that's something that a lot of people are going to remember for quite a while when it came out of the blue like it did.
The history of Campolindo in terms of playoffs is that we've built our program up to a level where we expect to get into the playoffs. We had 2 years where we made it into the playoffs as a low seed. Both, you know, in 2010, we were at 5-5. And we were at 6-4 the year before. And so those were low seeds going in. We had to play some pretty stiff competition, lost in the first round, and that was rare.
And with Campolindo, I mean, they had finished in last place the year before. They were 1-5 in league. They still made the playoffs because they finished 5-5 overall.
Each rider will be in charge of a league, and you'll call each coach in the league, and you'll get their list of players who they think are coming back, newcomers, returners, guys they lost, and just have a conversation about what they think the season's going to be like and what they need to do to be successful.
You know, our kids got a laugh when they saw the rankings. We never play up to rankings. We never boast that we're a power. The kids know. They know who we are.
Paper had us coming in last, which, you know, it made sense at the time because we're coming off a poor season, losing a bunch of the seniors.
On both sides of the ball, we were struggling just to piece lineups. We were just figuring out, can we field a team in 2011?
And, you know, Coach Macy's definitely one of those guys that, you know, downplays what they have.
I really keep it close to the vest in terms of what type of team we have. And some people think I'm sandbagging. It's like, wait a second, we're not sandbagging. We're still trying to figure out if we've got a team. Every year, it's the challenge. You know, we don't know what we have until we get to that first game.
And our people that talked to, you know, Coach Macy before the season, it was, well, you know, we don't have any linemen. We don't have this. We don't have that.
Up to the start of the season, our biggest struggle, could we find five linemen? You know, nobody knew where the season was going because the scramble was just to find the lineup. And then once we got the lineup together, we didn't know how well it would perform.
Right before our first game of the season, it was a Thursday shed meeting. And I remember the coaches came up in the shed and they all talked. They said their 2 cents about what we had to do the next day. And then all slowly the players stood up, started saying stuff, pumping each other up. And then I think I was one of the last ones to stand up. And at this point, I was just so infuriated with what everyone was saying about us. They're not going to win a game. 0-6, no returning starters. Our fans weren't even behind us at this point. And it was demoralizing because we knew that we were a lot better. We knew we'd all put in all this work, and how could you say that we're nothing? And so at that point, I went over, I locked the door, and in front of everyone, just like, look left, look right. No one else matters. We'll unlock that door when the season's over, but this is our family, this is our brotherhood, and this is who we're gonna fight for.
A couple early games, you know, we got off to a good start because we had a good summer and a good Reno, okay. Then the real tester was when we got to El Cerrito.
El Cerrito.
The El Cerrito game.
El Cerrito.
That El Cerrito game. Started with the El Cerrito game.
I didn't have any high expectations on it, but it was like, okay, I just took it as a challenge.
That was a hostile environment, really talented athletic team, teams that we'd like struggled against in the past.
And that game really, I think, surprised a lot of people. I think it surprised our kids, surprised our coaches. It was not played as a typical preseason game. That boy, that night, you felt it. You felt something different about it. It had a playoff atmosphere to it. It had high stakes football written all over it. It was only game three. When we came out for a little lap around the field, and boy, the screaming and the yelling and the noise.
Early in the game, I think it was their El Cerrito's first offensive possession. They threw a fade to one of their fast receivers, Griffin Pyatt, who got caught behind him and chased after him. And after 40 yards of chase, dove and tripped him up.
Right after that, made a goal line stand. Fidelli knocks down like three fades in a row on their best receiver.
Macy was hitting me hard with this receiver that was supposed to be so great. He was only a sophomore, but a big and fast kid. His name was Jalen Harvey. And Macy was all up in my face the whole week. Fidelli, he's gonna beat you deep. Fidelli this, Fidelli that. And I was so confident in myself when I went into that game. It was just like, screw this kid. I'm gonna bring this kid down. I want him to cry, like everything. And so when I got on that field, they tested me right away. They had a big run and got all the way down to the goal line, about 5 yards off. And then they did three passes in a row of that guy, and I knocked all of them down.
He's getting amped, we're all getting amped, and that turnaround right on that goal line stand was like, maybe we could do this.
The physicality of a game like that, they'll look at a team like El Cerrito, and Coach Macy is different in that you can play the suburban-urban card, but Coach Macy's from Oakland.
We, muscled it out for, the whole game. That was tough, and they're big guys, a lot of big guys, a lot of D1 recruits, and for us to win that game. And afterwards, I remember, Coach Macy was so stoked. And I think he said something along the lines like, I didn't really even believe in you guys, and you pulled it out. And we're going, oh, thanks, Coach, but it was true. Not a lot of people knew we could go in and knock off a team like that. It's such a hyped up team, such a big team, so many big name recruits, and I think that kind of clicked for a lot of people. We can do big things.
You had to be on the field to feel the electricity, the atmosphere. Some reporters were there, but they weren't flooding that game thinking it was going to be a big watershed game. I think some of the reporters that left knew that that game was played different from any other game that they would expect to cover in a preseason in terms of non-league. So coming out of that game, our kids just took a different attitude.
That win at El Cerrito was big. And once we got that win, I think that was just huge for our confidence to understand that we beat a really good team on the road. And that kind of got the ball rolling in terms of momentum and confidence. I think that's the moment where it really started. I think that's when Coach Macy started talking about, like, this could be a special team.
And it was as they got into the league season, they still kept winning. They're having a pretty good year.
The Diablo Foothill League has three teams with 5-0 records coming into this week: Campolindo, Miramonte, and Las Lomas.
The Campolindo Cougars are led by quarterback Brett Stevens, who's thrown for almost 800 yards this season. Stevens and his Cougs ready to battle Ocalanis Thursday night.
And then it just rolled through league, and we were buying into the game plan. We knew what we needed to do against each team. Coach Macy played against these coaches so much that he knows the game plan against each team. And we bought into it, and we executed each week, and we just kept getting stronger and stronger.
We'd gotten through a couple of teams like Dublin and Doherty Valley, but if you can beat Miramonte at home in front of all these people, in front of the news, and when you're both 7-0, that was a huge stage for a lot of people. Man, that Thursday night, I remember everyone was saying, guys, this is going to be the biggest thing we've ever done in our lives. And it was to that point.
We were going into week 8, and we were 7-0 at this point. Miramonte was 7-0, and we were going to meet up on that Friday night. The previous year, Miramonte had kind of smoked us. And we knew that this was going to be a big game deciding our season. There was three teams left at 7-0. Any team could take league. Any team could go into the playoffs strong. And we knew that this was going to be a huge game for us. We had been doing well so far, but this was another big test for us. So we go out that week on Monday, going into practice, and Macy's all fired up. We're doing hitting right away, and someone makes a big play, and Macy calls him over, gets in his face, peels the sticker off, throws it right on his helmet. All of a sudden, he just has an 8 on the front of his helmet. He brings us all in, and he's like, "Do you know what that 8 stands for?" We're all, "Why is there 8 on him?" He's like, "Because we are playing Team 8. Not playing Marimani. There's no hype behind them. This is just another team. This is another week. This is Team 8.
The Marimani game when we were both undefeated here, that was sweet. That place was packed. Yeah, that was a special game.
I don't know how it got going, but they packed the stand.
Both communities were there. Like, it was thousands of people there. The news cameras were there. Yeah, I remember that was a game that going into it, there was a lot of butterflies.
I think that was the one, I think, okay, this is where it's going to end. This is where the run's going to end. Miramani was kind of the preseason favorite. This is where it was going to end. And they just blew them out. That was the game where, okay, this is something. They've got something here. I mean, it was, Miramani just couldn't believe themselves that game. It was, you know, turnovers and quick touchdowns and all that. And so at that point, you knew that this was a dangerous team.
That was a huge game. That was, most people agree, that was the turning point for our year.
A 10-0 team, you almost always have a level of skepticism because the scores are so lopsided. What will they do in a close game against a good team? They had El Cerrito on the resume in a close game, so that worked in their favor. But as I remember it, they were never going to get the number one seed because Marin Catholic was so good. They had Jared Goff. They had all these guys that everyone had heard of. And here's Campo. You know, maybe they're a fluke, maybe they're not.
We knew we were going to get a first-round game that we should be able to handle. We felt confident with that. The big thing in part of our traditions are bonfires. If we get the playoffs, we do bonfires.
I'm Sam Perry, and I'm here to introduce the all-leaguers of the Campolindo Cougars.
These kids, they live for their bonfires because it's very introspective. It is just them. The kids open up. They have some emotional things to share. You know, we don't direct kids what to say. You know, if a kid wants to get up and speak. But it's a big deal to them.
Tomorrow when Bishop O'Dowd steps out on that field, they're going to try and take all of that from us. We've put way too much into this. This will not end tomorrow. You will fight until the bitter end, and you will give everything you have for this team and for what we have accomplished.
Going into the second round game, O'Dowd, you know, I think most of our coaches felt, well, maybe this is it. You know, at least we got to a Thanksgiving game at Campo, which is a big deal. For us, the truth is our goal every year, and our kids know the goal. If we can make it to Thanksgiving, we've met our goal for the year.
One of Macy's themes the whole year was getting a Thanksgiving playoff game at home.
Coach Macy loves the Thanksgiving week. I mean, his goal every year is to make the Thanksgiving game.
That's a huge deal for all of our kids because every ex-player that comes back from college, that the biggest thing for them is to be able to come back to one of our games. If we're playing at home, Thanksgiving, they load our sidelines.
It creates the most amazing atmosphere on the sideline. You have, especially for this year, we had about 30 people, 30 guys from previous years, you know, all wearing their Letterman jackets, wearing Campo football gear, or just out there to just watch us win. And they just created this whole scene where you're not just playing for yourselves. You're playing for, you know, the guys who came before. You're playing for, you know, Campo football. And I think that's a big part of why Coach Macy loves that week so much. You're not just playing for yourself. You're playing for a legacy.
We got to O'Dowd at home, Thanksgiving. It was going to be a big deal. It was going to be a big deal. Win or lose, it was going to be a big deal.
Dowd punched us in the face for sure.
You knew for them it was going to be a physical game, but it just we're so well coached and so well tuned that, you know, they just were always in a position to, you know, okay, let me brush off that hit and let's go make a play. And,
we just kept getting up and kept going. A few of us didn't feel very good the next morning, but that was part of it, and it was a good victory.
And all the times that Brett got knocked down, all the times that Griff got knocked down, and they just got back up. And I think that's what kept us going. I think Bishop Adad expected, like, one of these hits is going to knock them down where they can't get up. And we kept getting up, and we kept scoring. We kept holding them while we were taking these big hits. And I think it was a big, big testament to our resiliency that we just kept getting back up and scoring touchdowns.
Is not winning lead or going 10-0. When we beat Miramonte, I said, that was nice. I kept asking, what was my goal for the year? And you guys would say, get to Thanksgiving. Then when we beat Las Lomas, league champs, 10-0, I said, that's nice, but you haven't met my goal yet. You guys would say, our goal was to get to Thanksgiving.
So I think what struck me about that Bishop O'Dowd game was, yes, we finally got a true sense of what they were going to do against a very physical team with pressure on the line, and I thought they played extremely well.
I think that really prepared us for the following week, because the following week was a big old resiliency game, just staying tough and not bending, not breaking.
Nobody goes up and scouts Cardinal Newman, so when we upset O'Dowd, we had no one had scouted. So, you know, you think about back to our game planning, well, luckily, we had played them two other years, and, if you want to go back to the way the 2010 year ended and how it had the irony and the that would take place going into 2011.
To kind of be the senior that's going up back at that field, and it's kind of like a clay, and it's all wet, and it's just a totally different vibe than the turf we're used to, and, you know, it's another great Carl Newman team. And so it's kind of weird 4 years later, you know, in the same situation. And so it was a really special game for me.
So demanding, the seasons are so long now. In Northern California, you play enough, and the playoffs bring all the good teams together. You're going to play against the same dozen teams all the time. The same dozen teams are going to be there.
Our really good team in 2008, they went up there and lost. That was when they were in the D2 playoffs. And then we went up there the previous year and just got killed our junior year. And it was, I think it was fitting because it was like the ultimate test for our team. We'd been through a lot, and we've overcome a lot. But like the, I don't know, at that point in Campo football, it was the biggest test was Cardinal Newman.
Just like in 2008, 2010, and 2011, all started the same way. And when we preached going into the 2011 game, we cannot let these things happen. And what happened in the two prior games, we get the opening kickoff, we go 3-and-out, bad punt, they get short field, they score. In all three of the games, we go down 14-0. It's carbon copy.
We were dead to rights. Definitely all the same thoughts, like, oh no, not again, Carl Newman.
They go up 21-0. Okay, all right, let me just get my speech ready at halftime to sum up the season. The kids did more than we expected them to do. I'm just running some thoughts through my head to get the kids in a better place.
And then we get the interception by Carl, and then it just started rolling. We scored a touchdown. They decide to throw the ball with 18 seconds left. We get the ball back, and then,
you know, we're just going to do a Hail Mary.
We just put four receivers out and just pretty much said, had Carl and Griffin just run the end zone. I was just going to heave it to them. But I knew they needed to buy some time because we were pretty far out. So I just tried to buy as much time as I could, rolling out. And then I'm coming back left, and I saw Carl's guy fall. And I go, uh-oh. And then I'm rolling left, but I have to throw all the way back to my right. I go, all right, and just planted my feet and just chucked it. And then I got crushed. So I was on the ground. I didn't even see Carl catch the ball or go in or anything. I just heard the roar. That was definitely the spark in that game.
We're lining up for the PAT, I get all the kids together. Zero time on the clock. We're going in at halftime. We have to go both through the same gate. So I'm telling our kids, I said, listen, everyone, as soon as that ball goes through the upright, you sprint. You sprint and you cut them off. You beat them to the gate and you make as much noise as you can, you know, as you run through the gate in front of them. So we go in at halftime, and you know, I had my speech that I was all prepared to give, and also we're changing it. We're back in the game.
The game turned around in a remarkable amount of time.
They bring in another kid, run a sweep, we come up, our kid strips it, we flatten him out, the ball gets stripped. So all of a sudden we're at midfield. We had put in, we'd worked on a little bit of a flea flicker play. So Chris Schofield, you know, he was calling the plays, he comes running over. And he goes, why do you think you had to do it right now?
I think it was our first offensive play in the second half.
I remember when the play call came in, and I'm sitting there, this is going to be a touchdown.
So I played quarterback my freshman year here, or like a little bit freshman year, and then I played my sophomore year. So I had a little bit of quarterbacking history. So they had that play in their back pocket where I was a receiver out on the edge.
And Griffin Pyatt had been... He'd done some quarterbacking as a freshman, as a sophomore on JV. So the one problem, he plays with gloves. So he knows he has to take his gloves off for this play to work. Well, the way it's set up, the way, you know, we had to set it so, you know, the ball's on the hash close to our sideline, the three receivers are now over on their sideline. I'm going, oh my gosh, hope no one on their staff notices he's pulling his gloves off while he's standing at the line of scrimmage.
Brett would throw it to me behind the line, and then I'd throw it down to somebody else. And so
went to Griffin Pyatt, and then he threw it to me.
Here we go, like, let's roll, it's a tie game, and then we just rolled them from there.
Thank you.
In the Campolindo game, when we were ahead by 21 points, I don't know if we've ever had a team in Cardinal Newman that has lost a 21-point lead. And Campolindo was a great team, but to be ahead 21 points and lose that, I don't think we've done that very many times. So that's a compliment to them.
We took that knee right at like the 3-yard line, and I turned around, and like our hundreds of fans who traveled 2 hours to Santa Rosa were storming the field.
And just having all our fans just rush the field. And I remember one of my buddies came up to me and just like absolutely jumped on me. We're all cheering together. And then everyone kind of piles in and this slow chant start. We're going to the ship. What? We're going to the ship. What? I'll never forget that moment.
The magic is still there. The magic is still there. At the faculty meeting this week, Miss Kitchens wanted me to just address the faculty about the football team. And I said a few little stories about some of the magic of this year. September 30th, the team from 86 that came for their reunion, they came onto the field to talk to you guys. And they said, they just sort of looked at you guys and said, hey, you remind us of us back when we played. Nothing special, but just a bond. And then I talked about the Miramani game. And I told the faculty, I said, I never turn and look at the stands when I'm coaching the game. But this year, at the Miramani game, and at this game tonight, our crowd is so incredible. Our student body is so awesome. At the Miramani game, I just had to turn around and just enjoy our student body and the way they fire things up for you guys, even tonight or all.
Right. Yeah.
Everybody's coming in.
That was my favorite game of theirs that season, just because it was so improbable. You know, you didn't think they'd be able to go up to Cardinal Newman and win anyway, and then you fall down 21-0, and it's, you know, they were close to conceding, but. The shocked looks on the faces of Cardinal Newman at halftime there just told the whole story, and you knew it was going to be really tough for Cardinal to come back in that second half and recover from that. Even though they still had the lead, they were shell-shocked.
We never really expected to go to the NCS championship at the beginning of the year. No one else did. You know, we had confidence in ourselves, but I don't think anyone was looking that far ahead. So after that Cardinal Newman game, it all came a reality.
Great things kept happening, and I think it was just all says that like hard work pays off. All that the work we had put in through the year, through the summer, through the 4 years, for all the kids who went to the camps, it was all building to this moment to get us to this final game.
They didn't say where the 3A championship was going to be played. They did state that two of the levels would play at the Coliseum. But I just knew, you know, I told the kids, we're going to the Coliseum. It came out the next day that they would then play our game against Marin Catholic at the Coliseum. We're both undefeated. In fact, they even moved our game to the second game. They had De La Salle play San Ramon before us and made our game the marquee game. And the place was packed for it.
We went to watch them play on that Saturday. And I think me and a few other guys kind of got the sense that we could play with them just by watching them. We knew the history of their program. They're a good program, private school, big and physical. Quarterback was a good player. So we knew it was a big challenge, but we felt like the Cardinal Newman game was probably more difficult. And then we're moving forward. We just had fun with it all week.
So during the week, you know, it was just all through the school, through the halls and classes, on the football field, during practice. It was just tons of energy in the air.
We head out on the bus, and there's like hundreds of cars, of campout cars, all honking. They have all these like signs.
The whole caravan, the whole town was behind us. It wasn't like just our team was going to the game. You know, it was like Moraga was coming with us. And when you feel like that kind of support behind you, you feel unstoppable. And I think our team really got picked up by the community. Just gave us that last bit of energy.
So we all organized the convoy behind the bus and honking all the way through town. I got to the point where you really wondered if you were going to do damage to your horn as you're driving by, but we really made sure the horns were on full blast as we drove through Orinda, home of the Miramonte Matadors. When we went by the school and we went through downtown Orinda, but what was really cool is one of the parents had gotten there a little bit early and had gone down on the freeway at a freeway overpass and had hung a sign that said "Go Campo." And we all passed underneath it. It was magic, truly magic.
When we arrived, it was pretty sweet. We went in their little tunnel under the stadium, like all the other teams arrive. And then we went to the locker room, and that was pretty interesting, being in the visitors' locker room of the Oakland Coliseum, getting taped up in like the training room. It just felt kind of professional. We did and the coin flip under the stadium. That was interesting. Us captains went out there. We're all in our like sweats, and you know, we looked like we just woke up. And they're all ready to go. Marin Catholic was all in their uniform. Everything looked perfect. They're ready to take the field right there and then.
Just going down that dark tunnel, and it was silent. There were just those few claps, and then you know everything's echoing. You hear the crowd roaring above you, and it kind of comes up the tunnel, and then we're coming down. It was just a mix of that cold wind hitting us and those cheers. And you pop out and the lights are just so bright. It was just, you know, a sensory overload.
To head out, we headed out and start going right. And I don't know how we got so many fans to show up, you know, but it feels like the Coliseum's filled almost, you know, and you go see a red up there. And it was a confidence booster, yeah, but that's when it starts to sink in that this is the real deal. You got the lights shining down on you. You got the whole town out there. You know, you don't want to let anyone down. Yeah, a lot of pressure.
You see how big everything is and how awesome the field looks, and then the size of the crowd, even for warm-ups, was huge. And you just get goosebumps. There's no words that can describe the feeling of taking the field that night.
All excitement, you know, I'm a little nervousness here and there. You know, you're playing in the Oakland Coliseum. I'm a huge Raiders fan, so it was definitely just one of those dream come true. But but we were all excited. You know, you can't be overly nervous for that. Our offense started out pretty well. We scored a touchdown on our first drive.
There was something magical in the stands. It wasn't just your normal high school game, probably one of the bigger crowds that they've ever pulled in, you know, for that type of a situation. And it just made it all magical.
It was close going into half. It was close at the end of the game.
kind of knew it was such a close game that, you know, one play could be a difference. So your attention to detail on every play was just magnified. Every yard was important. But, you know, it was just being competitive as a group and understanding that you're going to take blows and you just got to keep battling until the end. But, you know, it was an intense game, intense moment. It was a, you had some adrenaline going for sure.
Towards the end, when it got close, that's when it became all real. I mean, I remember it was like third and goal or something. It was like really close to the end of the game. That's right before they kicked that field goal to take the lead. That's when it was real. I mean, we needed that stop, and we got it by like a few feet. And they kicked that field goal, and then for some reason, we just had no doubt that something was amazing was going to happen.
You start to realize, yeah, this is, you know, you knew before you could make mistakes, but this is it. Yeah, mistake and you're done. We got the ball. There was doubt, definitely, in everyone's. We got a long way to go, not a lot of time, but, you know, we had the ball. We knew there's a way this could work.
Really nice kick return from Carl to start it. So I think we're out by 30-35, which was a big, big step. And then I think it was the first or second play where we hit the big one to Mace, where they kind of left them.
Brett Stevens would scramble around a little bit, and I knew I could get behind the defense, and eventually Brett saw me right before he was about to tuck and run. Just lobbed it over the defense and found me wide open.
We get down there, run a couple plays, and then it becomes time for me to just waste a little bit of time. We want to run the clock out, so when we kick that field goal, game's over, and we're trying to get the ball kind of to the center of the field. And I'm playing running back, and the strategy here is just, you know, like, run it a little bit to the middle, take a tackle. Like, just run it a little bit, take a tackle. We don't need you running. Can't fumble the ball. Do not fumble the ball. And I run into a pile, you know, snap, run into a pile, take a couple steps, fall. And as I'm laying on the ground, and it's piling, one of them rips the ball in my arms, and their whole team just starts yelling, like, fumble, 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 like, screaming. I'm getting up like, oh, no, like, please don't buy it, ref. Like, please tell me you saw that. And I thought for a second, like, I had lost the game. And I was going to, yeah, that was it. That was, thank God, again, the ref. Ref saw it, but I was freaking out.
From our perspective, and I'm sure, as it turns out, Coach Macy had it completely under control. But as the time was ticking down, it didn't look like everything was completely coordinated. So I think we were all kind of choking a little bit, thinking, oh my God, the time is going to expire.
Anytime you deal with 3 points in high school football, you're nervous. Kicking in high school football is just not, you can have the best kicker in a high school ever, and you'll still have nerves because he's just not automatic. And if I remember correctly, Cookie was a sophomore at the time. So you're dealing with a sophomore place kicker who you need to drive down the field and get him in range to win a game to potentially go to a state title game. Okay, no pressure, sophomore.
I was just shitting my pants. Like, I was so scared. I was shaking so much. And I had butterflies, like the first game, you know, very scared.
I still thought we had time to go, but people were saying, you know, get ready for field goal, get ready for field goal. And so I'm out there warming up, kind of walking around, freaking out. Usually I stay pretty calm and collected, but that time I was just, you know, I almost felt sick.
Once Coach Macy yelled, all right, PAT, took my first steps on the field. Like, once I actually stepped on the field, everything just, like, just washed away.
I went out there, you know, snapped.
Mr. Perfect Pyatt holding for me. Snap was great.
The rest was black.
It was like one of those movies, like, you know how, like, in army movies or something, they, like, throw a grenade and you hear that, like, white noise, like that, ee! Like, I sort of heard that before. Like, I, my mind was just, it was weird. Like, I just couldn't hear the crowd yelling. And once I actually hit it, everything sort of just came back.
the environment overall at that game, and kick a game-winning field goal with no time left to go to the state title game. It was absolutely bedlam there, and it was a lot of fun to see.
To the center of the field for the awards presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give one big final round of applause to Campolindo High School, your 2011 North Coast Section Division III football champions. We want to congratulate both teams on an outstanding game and an outstanding season.
The students had completely cried. I think the entire student body had gone to the Oakland Coliseum that night, and they were all sitting in front, all in their colors and all doing their cheers. And when the game was over, the entire football team congratulated one another, but immediately ran to the student section in front of the stadium. And that was truly touching.
We took our team picture, and then the rest of the team went into the locker room, and me and my two buddies, Sam Perry and Tim Meyer, we stayed out on the field and we were taking pictures. We had our camera lady, Karen Drinkwater, take some pictures of us, and that was kind of fun, staying on the field extra long. We actually got kicked off at the field. We just never wanted to leave. We never wanted that moment to end.
The bus ride home was crazy. All I can remember, I mean, it's a blur to me because it was so fun, but I just remember driving home, and all of a sudden we got in the parking lot, and there was this huge crowd sitting there. I didn't know if it was Marine Catholic coming to kill us or if it was just our fans, but it turned out to be our fans, and they started rocking the bus, and man, we got off, and they were cheering. I mean, it was one of the greatest days ever.
After winning North Coast in 2011, I felt it was going to be unfair to try to have the next group of kids try to measure up to that. It was a miracle. But surprisingly, you know, that those 2 years after that, we've never made any connection to 2011. You just can't put that pressure on the kids. But we've had two big years that are hard to explain. The irony was that I don't know what the carryover effect was in their minds. There had to be some. We didn't want to compare them, but there had to be a confidence level because, gosh, they probably had just as much of a miracle year. We went 9-1 that year, and the difference was everybody we played brought their A game. All of a sudden, there was just this animosity, the vitriol, just the venom, just the hatred everywhere we went. We went up to Reno that year. Everybody just wanted a piece of us. They wanted to start fights. Every game we played in 2012 was loaded with some type of an anger. And I think it, you know, when you look back, I think it was because there's no Cinderellas.
A reason behind it, but they just don't do it in the generic way that most coaches would, and this program isn't a generic program, and it kind of just ties in with everything that this is more than just a high school football team.
chance. I guess if it was all that easy, we wouldn't break trees, we wouldn't even need this. Yeah,
back up, feet, back up, push it, Mark. Biden, push it.
Somebody just can't come from the outside and figure out why things work here. We've built up so many crazy traditions the kids love. It's a year of tradition. I feel that the kids have to believe they're playing for something bigger than the sport.
A lot of my ex-players now coming back.
And that's my Microsoft Word to my mother. Why can't we just live and enjoy each other? Cause either way you look up at the world that we cover, we all end up being
I'm
in a beautiful position. That's why I'm asking you to encourage some ambition and chalk it all up, or this talk is all bluff. I'm starting from the ground till I build it all up. Yeah, and can you learn from me? And I promise I will learn from thee. Gonna teach the world these lyrics.
1, 2, 3 What we do in the off season, whether it's some type of entertainment or it's that off season work that we do, everything just ties into these kids learning how to group with each other and know that this is who you trust in this world.
We didn't know who'd still be around playing at the end of today.
Our kids are too smart to sit there and, oh yeah, we're going back to state again. You know, they're here to do the best they can and ride it out as long as they can. Once we've got them invested and bought in, they just want to make it last. So when we do go to playoffs, it's only about, can we just make it last one more week? Football doesn't have Cinderella stories.
Just Campo.
We were passing time, getting high with the best friends. Living life, eating vibe, learning lessons. Didn't need no struggle, we were good for life. We didn't need no place to rest. Back in the day, all we ever wanted was the neighborhood thing. Big Mo slanging Lucy's to the neighborhood gang. Like four for a dollar, four for a dollar. My dude got locked on a misdemeanor. The other one shipped off to Korea. Life gets tough, getting harder to see her. They know I'm a holler, they know I'm a holler. We were passing time, getting high with the best friends. Living life, feeding vibe, learning lessons. Didn't need no struggle, we were good for life. We didn't need no place to rest. Our awfully burdened heads. Back then the air was fresh and we were good for life.
We were just kids. We were just kids. We were just kids. It is what it is. We were good. We were just kids. We were just kids. We were just kids. It is what it is. We were good for life.
Because my
days were made to get up in love. Pushing pedals on the road under Pelican suns. Wishing I never would have moved out from that town. But it's done, it's done. Yo, the chain link fences tried to border me up. You got an ice cold soda, better order me one. And always tune your life to the beat of the drum. Before you're old and wise, gotta be young and dumb. And we were passing time, getting high with our best friends. Living my feet and right, learning lessons. Didn't need no struggle, we were good for life. We didn't need no place to rest. Just kids.